3, 2, 1.
Hello, my name is Bas Triets. I'm the Chief Technology Officer of Mimetas in the Netherlands, and I'm very happy for this opportunity to tell you a little bit about the work we've been doing at Mimetas in trying to develop the best tissue models for researchers to help them develop new therapies. And I'll start off with telling a little bit about us as a company. We've been around for about 6 years. We're headquartered in Leiden in the Netherlands, but we also have sites in near Washington and in Tokyo. And at these different sites, we have one mission, and that is that we are dedicated to providing researchers with the best tissue and organ models to enable them to develop the new medicines for the 21st century. And where we are situated in this drug development pipeline is primarily in the preclinical phases. So we deliver tools for primary screens, secondary screens, but also the tox and safety related stages of the preclinical drug development pipeline. And we really want to offer researchers with our organ-on-a-chip technology a way to better capture disease phenotypes, to better capture the differences between patients, and all of that by really mimicking the complexity of tissues as they are in the patient. Because, of course, as we all know, there is a very big gap between the conventional 2D cell culture and or animal models and what drugs actually do in the human body. And we want to bridge that gap so that our in vitro research is much more predictive and enables us to make better decisions in what drugs we want to push through in the drug development pipeline and have it make it to the clinic and prevent them from only failing later in the pipeline. And we think that to be able to have these very predictive models, but also to be able to generate tools that allow us to get a better understanding of intricate disease mechanisms, we need to cover some aspects that are generally lacking in the conventional ways of doing in vitro research. And one of them is, of course, that we want to stick with human tissues. Animal models have all the complexity and all the components that you would want in a tissue, but they are simply not human, and the results that you get out of those tests are also typically poorly translatable to the human situation. So if we then stick to human materials, there's other aspects that we think are really integral to having a well representative model of the in vivo situation. And that is that we always culture cells in 3D. We do that by mixing our cells with matrices, so matrigel or collagen. We think you need the combination of multiple cell types in that three-dimensional setting to really capture the complex architecture of tissues in the body. And another very important aspect of that is vascularization. We really believe vasculature is an integral part of the response to certain stimuli of tissues. It's an integral part in being able to make tissues in the size and scale that they simply are in the body. And by culturing our cells in a continuously perfused, vascularized setting, we can really provide our cells with this microenvironment that they also experience in the body. And that allows these cells to also respond to drugs or stimuli or to disease aspects as they would do in the body. So this is what we want to achieve. How do we do it? Well, using this very, very simple platform. If you look at it, it looks like a 384 well plate. That is by intent. It is just a 384 well plate, but the magic is in the bottom. So if you look at the bottom of this titer plate, you see that there are channels linking different wells up together, and it's in those channels that we have a very high level of control over what liquids interact with what cells at what point in time, and that allows us to build the build tissues as we want them. But I think that a movie says more than 1,000 pictures here. And the first is, okay, so what happens in those channels? Well, there's a core technology that allows us to build up tissues as we want them, and that's phase guide technology. It is what we use to pattern and or subdivide these channels into different compartments. So if you look at this movie, you see that if somebody would pipette a gel or an ECM into these microfluidic channels, there are little ridges patterned on the bottom of these microfluidic channels. They are not membranes or walls or whatsoever. They are just a simple ridge on the bottom of this chamber, and through capillary forces, they prevent that gel from flowing into the entire microfluidic network, which would render it unusable, but limited to where we want these cells to, these gels to end up. And actually, this movie shows the whole story a little bit better. So again, if we look at a simple normal 384 well plate, if you flip it over, you can see that in this case, each time four wells are linked up together to form 96 chips, where each of the wells has their own specific function. The first of them is needed to just add your gel in. So by using normal conventional pipettes, you can pipette in 1 microliter of, for example, collagen or matrigel mixed with cells, and that then aligns with that ridge here. That's the phase guide I showed before as well. After then allowing that gel to gelate, you can pipette media into the other correlating well, so in the second well, and that will flow alongside your gel compartment from the second well into the fourth well. The third well where these two channels meet, that's where actually your experiment is being performed. So the tissue that is suspended in the gel will be provided with nutrients and oxygen from the perfusion flow. They will form complex three-dimensional structures. And because it's a glass-bottomed 384 well plate, you can then just stick this plate in any of the equipment you have available in the lab. In this case, just a research microscope, but also high-content microscopes and other tools can be used to quickly image all of the chips in one plate and really do and look at what's going on in each of those individual cultures. These are just some examples of types of tissue culture that you can do in those channels, but I'll dive into some of them in a little bit more detail right now. I was talking about flow a little bit, that medium flows from the second well into the fourth well, thus providing nutrients and oxygen to the tissue you're culturing inside the plate. But we don't use pumps for that. We actually just use gravity. So by simply placing these plates on a rocker platform that tilts one way, keeps a plate at an angle for maybe 10 minutes, that allows the liquids to equilibrate from the left well towards the right well, forcing a continuous flow through the microfluidics. And after these liquids get close to equilibrating, the rocker platform flips around, tilts it the other way, so the flow reverses and you maintain a continuous flow through all of the 100 chips in parallel without having to hook it up to tubes or pumps or anything like that. Another advantage of having plates that are just 384 well format that don't require tubes or whatever is that these plates are so compatible with the equipment out there. So not only for imaging, but also for loading or handling or dosing your plates, these things are completely automation compatible. So this was a obviously real-time image or movie of automatically seeding, loading, and providing media to a stack of plates that just goes to show that if you have infrastructure already available to perform experiments or readouts, chances are the organoplate will fit in very, very smoothly. So what are the different things you can do with these types of plates? So the first example that I want to dive into is in the field of neurons. What you see on this slide on the top is a maximum projection of a network of iPS-derived neurons that have been cultured inside the organoplate. And actually, in the middle, you see a movie of a confocal imaging Z-stacks one after the other. So you can really see that this is a full three-dimensional network that forms throughout the ECM and that gives a very intricate level of interaction between those neurons. And moreover, in the bottom panel, if you look at calcium imaging, you can actually directly also look at the activity of these cells. So the big increase in fluorescence that you just saw pop up was actually the reaction of neurons to a seizure-inducing compound. So I'll start it once more. You see that there's a very low level of base activity, but there is spontaneous activity. Everything that lights up is an active neuron. And once you expose it to a seizure-genic compound, you see that all of them suddenly light up and go crazy. And this is just a very simple example of how you can use, in this case, iPS-derived cells, grow them in a three-dimensional network, look at their different protein expression, but also are able to do more direct functional assays, in this case, using calcium imaging. Another example that was quite fun recently was that we were in a collaboration with Hans Klevers from the Ubrecht Institute in Leiden, in Utrecht, where they used the organoid technology in a fairly novel way, namely to make organoids from snake venom glands and actually produce snake venom. Based on that, they were also looking for a nice way to test the effectiveness of that snake venom. And what we did was we took muscle cells, cultured them in 3D in the organoplate, and actually on the top you see a functional stain, or you see a normal stain of the muscle cells. And in the bottom two panels, these are again calcium imaging. This is again calcium imaging as a readout. With the top movie, so the middle panel in this one, showing you the activity of the myotubes in response to carbachol. So these are muscle cells being triggered. And what you see is, now I will start the bottom movie, but you will see that hardly anything happens there anymore, because these are the muscle cells that were treated with snake venom. They are completely paralyzed. So this trigger that would normally really activate myotubes in the muscle model, it's rendered completely ineffective. And it was great fun working with this type of innovative ways of using both organoid technology and 3D cell culture. And we were very happy to publish that in Cell earlier this year. So far, these examples have shown you the organoplate two-lane. This means that there's two lanes next to each other, as was also shown in the movie, one lane filled with a gel, one lane used for perfusion. But we also very often use a system that allows you a little bit more creativity and a little bit more flexibility. That's the organoplate three-lane. And it basically is what it says, what the name implies. Instead of having two lanes next to each other, now there's three lanes next to each other, where typically the middle lane is filled with a gel, and the two flanking lanes are used for perfusion, and where you can do a little bit more intricate cell culture. One example that we use this three-lane setup is in the field of pancreatic cancer. And in looking at the effect of flow alongside or through such a tumor model. And what we see in there is that if we look at the problems that people normally are faced with in pancreatic cancer, is that it's very difficult to get drugs to go into pancreatic cancer. And we were looking at, okay, so what does that mean? Do we see a very big difference if we just flow drugs alongside the tumor, or if we actually provide much more perfusion also through the tumors themselves? And what we see is that we indeed get a complete different phenotype and also genotype between these different flow regimes. So forcing an interstitial flow through cell through these tissues makes them actually more resistant, induces proliferation, induces transporter, It induces proliferation and transporter expression, and that means that there's actually a lower gemcitabine resistance. So the fact that we induce this more active phenotype makes these cells more more effective by treatments like gemcitabine. These were examples of cells that are cultured in 3D by suspending the cells inside the gel. But there's actually a second way in which the we use our platform quite extensively, and that is by growing tubes. So in that case, instead of suspending the cells in the gel, we put the gel, we put the cells in the perfusion channel. And as we look, as we can show in this movie again, you would start with an empty gel on the right. On the left, we pipette in just a microliter of a cell suspension. Then we would take a plate, simply put it on the side to let gravity help sediment the sides against the gel. And then once we start perfusion, these cells grow around and into a tube like this. So here on the right, the part that looks empty, there's a gel. And on the left, you really have a tube formed of cells. And that interface between the gel and the cells, that's really just the cells there. There's no membranes or pillars or something blocking the interaction. So that's actually a very interesting compartment where you can look at the at transport and barrier activity, transport effects across these cell layers, but also, for example, the migration of cells across these barriers. So we use these tubes for different applications. These are some pictures of proximal tubule grown in the version of such tubes, where you really see perfect polarization of the proximal tubule. You see nice, you see all the features you would expect on both sides. And you can do that, as we published a little bit earlier, with cell lines, but also, again, you can go and try and use the best cell sources that you can. And in this case, we've also been using epithelial organoids to form tubes from. So here we took organoids as a source, took them out of those organoids, grow them in into a tube shape. And the benefit of that is that these tubes on the front and the back of them, they are, again, still attached to the in and outlet wells. So you combine that very nicely phenotypically relevant or physiologically relevant cell source of organoids that typically always have one problem, and that is that they are a ball. So you only have access to the basal side, but not to the apical side of the cells. In this case, if we take those cells and culture them in the tube form, we basically get the best of both worlds. We see nice using the organoid workflow that allows you to have good access to patient-derived tissues, because you can multiply and expand the cells from patients. And what we see is that we can actually look at the transporter activity in those tubes, model them, and make and really try and understand why some drugs work better on some patients than others. Another amazing bit of work that was done by scientists outside of our group using this kidney model was really to model a glomerulus. So instead of sticking to the proximal tubule, they were really able to mimic the proximal tubule by combining podocytes and endothelium in a three-lane setup. And it was quite interesting to see there that these cells started to really deposit their own basal lamina components, and really started to more and more form their own microenvironment as they also would do in the body. And what was actually for me the most stunning thing that they could see here is that this was not just a way to make a glomerulus that just looked better or nicer, but what they actually saw is that they could really also get a direct induction of a disease phenotype from patients by making these this glomerulus model and then taking serum from people with membranous nephropathy. And once you actually perfuse this glomerulus model with the sera from disease patients who have basically a leaky glomerulus, you could see that exposing it to that disease serum, you also induce the leakage in this glomerulus model, while if you have serum from healthy patients, you actually maintain a nice barrier function of these tubes. For me, a very creative way to really get so close to the mechanism that are actually causing diseases in humans and trying to get tools to model this better, to understand what's going on, but also to predict the effectiveness of drugs on different patient populations. Another big way that we've been using tubes was by using still actually very simple cells, but extremely robust and scalable, KCO2 cells, intestinal model. Again, a similar setup. We grow a tube next to against the gel. And the way we leveraged these ones was actually not so much to go into details with only one or two tubes, but to do a little bit more larger scale research. So this is some data we published already several years ago, but I wouldn't be surprised if still to this time it is actually the largest organ on a chip data set published, because every bar that you see here is a different time point of experiments where we look at the barrier integrity of gut tubes as they are exposed to toxic compounds. And you can real time look through across time and across concentrations how these tubes react to pharmacological intervention. These tubes are you can grow them yourselves, but one of the latest things we've also been doing recently is we've started to offer these tubes in a assay ready format. So if you have interest in looking at barrier function or permeability assays or transport assays across KCO2 cells, where you really want them to be in a more relevant environment where they are grown in a three-dimensional shape and where they are cultured just in the presence of an ECM without any filter membranes or anything like that in the way to skew or bias your data, these are now available off the shelf, where you can simply buy a plate, take off the blister, add your compounds, and do the research as you want it. So I think it's another way in which we are trying to make this research as easy to do and as accessible to everybody as possible. Then there's, of course, some of the data I just showed, where we look at a fluorescent compound that you put to the inside of the tube and see if it's maintained and contained inside of the tube or that it diffuses out. But these are all optical readouts. You need to actually image it, and it's a way that's being done also traditionally, but there's of course a big body of data already out there where we use electrical characterization of these tubes. And we got so many requests from people saying, we'd love to use your 3D tubes, but we need to be able to compare it to our data that we already have. We want to do tear measurements, transendothelial electrical resistance measurements, but we don't know how to do that in your system. So to meet that demand, we actually went out and developed a measurement instrument to be able to work with these. And how that thing works is shown a little bit by this movie, where we have a small instrument that just fits, that's basically the footprint of a titer plate, and you dip in a board full of electrodes that you just put on the plate as if it was a lid. You click on the measurement unit on top, and this just hooks up to a laptop directly to drive the measurement electronics. And these measurement electronics drive a frequency sweep to perform impedance spectroscopy across your tubes. So in one go, with one click, you measure for all of the tubes on a plate, from tubes on either side of the gel, the electrical characteristics of these tubes, and it allows you to get a very fast and direct feedback on the health and the viability of these tubes and if their permeability is being modified in any way. Data that comes out of this can also be very dense. You can use it to monitor growth of tubes, to see when these are ready for your pharmacological intervention or for any other research that you want to do. But you can also, of course, directly look at effects that exposures have on these cells. So it's really a powerful tool to do real-time and highly parallelized measurements in a very scalable way on the organoplate. Growing these type of tubes using KCO2s is of course nice because it fits in with all of the legacy data that's out there. It's a highly standardized model system, but also here we couldn't resist and really wanted to also use the best cells that are out there. So again, similar to the kidney work we showed before, we've been also applying the same rationale of taking cells from colon organoids that maintain all of the aspects of the patient that the organoids were derived from, and take them out of that spherical or that ball-shaped modality where you only have access to the outside of the organoids. Take these high-quality cells and put them into a little bit more accessible format by growing them as tubes in the organoplate. And what we then really can start leveraging is that we can maintain this the physiology of these cells. So we've used these cells to model IBD. So by taking colon organoid derived tubes, culturing them normally, or triggering an IBD phenotype by exposing them to cytokines, we can really see the responses that you would expect. So we can see using TEER, we can see a reduction of the permeability when we expose it to cytokines. So you see that you can really get this inflamed phenotype of having a leaky gut. And we see a reduction in barrier function, an increase in permeability, but we also see a release of IL-8, also again what you would expect in an inflammatory response. Moving away from gut, there's also we've been also doing a lot of work in the field of blood vessels. So we really like adding vasculature to our organs, and that of course starts with growing a healthy base blood vessel. And here you see some pictures of what such a tube would look like, and also that by exposing them to different growth factors, you can really modify and change the morphology and the function of those tubes. And again, like with the gut, where we can also recapitulate that inflammatory phenotype, we can do the same in vasculature as well. So here you can see an increase in ICAM expression upon TNF-alpha exposure. But for me, more importantly, we can also take such a tube, perfuse it with monocytes, and really recapitulate the monocyte recruitment pathway. And you see here that perfused monocytes would normally just roll through and only barely attach to one of these microvessels, but in this case, upon TNF-alpha exposure, you see that more and more monocytes adhere to these tubes, and they don't only stick and adhere, but you can actually also see that these cells start rolling, attaching, and also extravasating outside of these tubes, as you see here in red. Nice movies are always nice, but if you want to take it towards a screen, you want to also be able to quantify it a little bit more, and that's also what you see here. On the left, you see a full chip where there's a tube of endothelium on the top. We've got tumor cells on the bottom channel, and in the middle, what you see there, all the red dots are actually immune cells that are attracted by the tumor cells on the bottom and are migrating out of the tube into the middle. On the right, you can actually you see a little bit of a zoom in of the same, but you can imagine that it's actually fairly straightforward to quantify how many cells are in that middle compartment on their way to the source of the inflammatory cues. Taking it one step further, going away from solid tubes is going for angiogenesis. So what you see here is is something that started off as a normal mother tube, as we call it, on the top, but where we provided cues for cells to sprout into the gel channel. In the middle, you see a cross-section of it, and on the bottom, where you can really see that these are hollow tubes that cross throughout the gel, and they really form a perfusible network of microvasculature that pushes all the way down. And this is, of course, a process that you can study, that you can see what actually modifies or promotes or reduces this angiogenesis. For example, looking at tumor treatments, but we can also use it to make our models better ourselves. And to do that, we use a different plate again. That's the plate you see here. It's and it looks a little bit like a three-lane, where there's still two perfusion channels, but in the middle, there's now a gel compartment that has an extra hole on the top where you can add a tissue from the top. So a little bit more schematically, what does that look like? One tube running from A1 to B1, another tube running from A3 to B3. In A2, you can pipe it in your gel, and B2 is the area really of interest, because that's where you have a compartment of gel with an open access on the top. This is what it looks like in real life. In red here, endothelial cells, so you've got two tubes flanking a little bit larger compartment of, in this case, collagen in the middle, with a hole on top that allows you to put stuff in later. And what we can do with that is, like you see here, is start off with two tubes, trigger angiogenesis towards the center, and once that angiogenesis hits the middle here, you see that we can drop on a spheroid or an organoid that then really gets into tight interaction with that vasculature. And for me, this is really where it's at, where we combine all the things we're talking about, we've been talking about before, take a complex three-dimensional tissue, merge it with this microvascular bed, really graft it on top, as you could normally only do in a PDX system in mice. Now we can actually take a tissue, vascularize it, and really give it all the stimuli that we need. One application where that really makes a difference can be, for example, by vascularizing a liver. As all of you know, liver is a highly vascularized organ where having this blood supply is key to give the media that need to be detoxified, that need to be filtered, and just having a blob of hepatocytes has always been difficult to keep stable and to keep highly functional. So trying to get a little bit closer to the in vivo situation of this highly vascularized tissue, we actually took a liver spheroid, put it on a vascular bed, and what you get here is actually this extremely connected and complex network of microvasculature that really goes into and through a spheroid of hepatocytes that then also start to produce a lot of albumin here stained in green, really showing the functionality of these hepatocytes. Looking into it in a little bit more detail, these are sections that were cut of these spheroids that were vascularized. You can see that at day one of co-culture, the vasculature is more or less only on the outsides of the sphere. At day seven of co-culture, the bottom middle panel, you see that the red vasculature has really penetrated all the way through that that liver tissue. And also, even if you look at it using the electron microscope, you can see that there is extremely tight interaction between the hepatocytes and the endothelial cells, also providing these characteristic structures of the interaction between the two. Of course, liver hepatocytes having high enzymatic activity is one part, but there is something that, that's typically very fairly difficult to recapitulate, and that's that there's also a bile duct and a bile side of the whole system. And what you see here in green is the formation of also a dense network of bile canaliculi that can take away all the bile that is produced after by the hepatocytes on the other on the side opposite to the endothelium. And actually, one of the great things of this is that all of the things I've showed you just yet were not just there in a N-1 situation. No, remember, this all still happens in a 384 well plate that's scalable, that's doable. So what you see here is actually just some data of a pilot screen that we did, where you see with all of these tissues that there is a huge effect of vascularization of these liver spheroids, that they give a significantly different phenotype from unvascularized spheroids and also from 2D sandwich culture. And it just goes to show that this is not a small scale and is one platform. No, you can combine this very, very high-end, high-level biology with a very scalable platform that really allows you to do full-scale research on the most complex tissues that you can imagine. One thing that I couldn't resist also still putting at the end is that, of course, I've been talking about vascularization of tissues. I've been talking about inflammation before. And for me also, of course, one of the real interesting things to do then is to combine those two together. So what we see here is on the left data that I also showed a few slides before, where you see that upon triggers, you get the inflammatory phenotype of your endothelium. But this we can, of course, also do inside a inside an organoplate graft with a vascular bed, and either by putting chemoattractants in ourselves or by having tissues that give off an inflammatory triggers, we can really see that we can recruit T cells into that dense network of microvasculature and also into the tumors or tissues that are vascularized on top of that. So I think this is a really interesting tool, and I'm very interested to see where this takes us. We are only scratching the surface here yet, but I'm sure you can all imagine the potential, for example, for immuno-oncology applications here. So as a final sort of summary, indeed, we can make large-scale perfusible microvasculature beds on top of which you can then add the tissue of your choice and do still at large-scale screens on these tissues. I hope to have given you with this a little bit of an overview of how we think we can really push forward the state of the art of current tissue models and combine the best and newest ways of doing cell culture using the best cell types at your disposal, organoids, iPS-derived cell types, in a very flexible and scalable platform where it allows you to do the best co-culture without actually having to move away from the readouts that you've been used to. So you can still do a high content screening, you can still do stain screens, you can still sample, you can still do tear measurements if you want to. And I believe that this yields a very, very strong set of tools for different researchers to get the best insights into disease mechanisms, but also to allow you to do, allows you to help make the best decisions in what drugs to put forward in development. And all of that would never have been possible if we wouldn't have a great team with a lot of people doing great science here in the Netherlands, but also in Japan and in the US. But of course, also not without the huge number of collaborations that we do with our customers in pharma and also with a lot of academic groups through various collaborations that we are always taking part in. So with that, I hope to have inspired you to have a look at this exciting new field in drug development, and I'd like to finish up with that. Thank you very much for your attention, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the event.